What's going on, good people? On this episode of the Paul Rivera Podcast, unfortunately, the quarantine edition, I have my guy, Mario Carbone. Mario, what up, baby?
What's going on, my man? What's going on?
Hey, before
I'm honored and thrilled to be on your show.
Oh, man, before we started recording, I told Mario I missed him. And he was like, shit, I miss everybody.
I miss everybody.
Wow, man. First and foremost, how are you? You, family, everybody good? Everybody healthy?
Thank God everybody's safe and sound.
Good.
I escaped the city. I'm in Montauk right now. But the family's good. You know, business is business right now. You know, it's a tough time for every business, every walk of life. It ain't easy out there, but you know, it's the same challenge in front of everybody.
I feel you. I feel you. I'm going to fuck you up right now. I'm actually in East Hampton. So I'm going to temperature. I'm going to send you test results, whatever you need. I'm eating at your house before this shit's over, for sure.
Yo. You're like down the block.
That's amazing. That's amazing, man. Listen, man, obviously, you know, a lot of people don't even know this. Like, we were supposed to do a show, shit, maybe a month ago at this point. Maybe, actually, like 2 months ago. Give or take, and then like the Kobe thing happened, right? And it was like we both agreed it wasn't the right time to do that, obviously. And then I reached out to you and was like, yo, like, given this quarantine, do you want to do the show? You're like, absolutely, like, let's figure it out, you know, whenever. When I see you have a bottle, let me get a bottle. What are you drinking?
I got a little Tignanello, baby.
You always keep it classic, brother.
You know, you got to keep it on brand, do it for the culture.
I'm gonna do a little burgundy.
All right.
Hey, you know Carlton?
Carlton.
The master song?
I don't think so.
The CEO of Heights Cellars. He's been at your restaurant.
Oh.
Definitely.
Sure. I know Heights.
Yeah, really good brother. He sent me this bottle, a little burgundy.
Ooh. That's nice.
Yo, so let's, you know, obviously, I want to talk about, like, present, and then we'll kind of go back to the beginning, your beginning. But,
yep.
You know, obviously a lot of people have been hit hard by this, and, you know, and it's crazy. I don't even want to talk about, like, the sick totals and the death totals, and, you know, it's probably as bad a situation as you can get. So I'm always cautious not to come off as, like, boo-hoo me, or, like, I'm going through something tough, or you're going through something tough. So I just want to put it in context. There's people going through, like, real shit, right? So
yeah.
That thing said, one of the industries hit the hardest has been, like, hospitality and restaurants and I'm not even asking specifics of Carbone or any of your establishments, but can you just talk about that a little bit? Like, how, like, what the thought process was, like, when it came down, when it got serious, the consideration to close restaurants, like, just a little bit of that thought process.
I think, you know, as it was going down, you're obviously, your first thoughts are, you know, kind of save yourself. You know, like, this thing's going, ships are going down. What do we have to do to not take on as much water as possible? How do we stay afloat in this catastrophe? And then once we were, you know, you go through the first round of really difficult decisions. You know, you have to make sure that there's going to be a company for people to come back to later. Mm-hmm. That's critical. Keep this thing afloat because we've never seen anything like it. There's no time period in place. We have absolutely no idea when this thing's going to come back. And we really don't know what it's going to look like when it does. My industry is the gathering of people in really close proximity.
Yeah.
So we don't really know what this is going to look like when we come back. But once we were able to sort of steady the ship, then your attention turns to, okay, phase two, how do we take care of our people? You know, what do we have to do as a company to take care of our people? What are we doing? Are we raising money? Are we doing different fundraisers, a reach out program, a scheduled Zoom calls where we gather people for book classes? And how do we keep people's minds active? How do we just keep people active? And those that are in most need, how do we make sure we identify? I mean, we were pre-corona, we were 1,500 staff deep, Major Food Group. So how do we keep contact with the people that are most in need? How do we make sure that they're going to be okay and have everyone stay afloat through this? And then once you get through that phase, you turn to, okay, I'm an industry leader. What do I have to do? What can I do for the community as a whole? How can we be a part of helping the broader scope of it all? I think what this has done for the restaurant industry is it's really shed light for people that didn't, it kind of pulled back the curtain a little bit, because we were immediately identified as one of the industries that was going to suffer the most. And I think it's resonating with people now, because it's been so well documented how tough, not just physically tough, but how just difficult of a business it is. We're riding on minor, really microscopic margins at times with you know, you're heavily leveraged, you've got high overhead, you're working with tight margins. You miss 1 week, you miss a couple days, you know, I mean, you're the whole thing's at risk. This whole house of cards goes down.
Yeah, I think that's something a lot of people don't understand, where it's like, you know, on a good day, the restaurant industry is challenging, right?
Yeah.
It's difficult. And then I think people, you know, I think people don't necessarily realize that the margins are that tight, even if you're at the top of the food chain, no pun intended, that a week can affect this thing, you know, in a real way.
It really mimics a lot of America, right? I mean, the restaurant industry was paycheck to paycheck, for to put it in context, you know, like we as a whole industry, we're kind of living paycheck to paycheck. I mean, thankfully I am blessed to have built this thing big and the responsibilities that go with that are heavy, but at times, you know, it provides us an opportunity to sort of, to be a safe haven right now, to feel like we're going to be okay. We're going to get through this, challenge accepted. We'll be all right on the other side of this. But for so many other restaurants, it really was that's the scenario, is it's paycheck to paycheck. So, you know, what does this look like when we come out of it? You know, New York City had 26,000 restaurants pre-corona.
26,000
restaurants.
Holy shit.
Yeah. That doesn't take fast food into consideration.
Wow. So that's real. That's not McDonald's, pizza.
Right.
Restaurants.
26,000. Right. So, I mean, it's, you know, we don't know. Every week that goes by, you know, I mean, the stimulus package, obviously, you know, it's doing what it can. And, you know, hopefully everyone's got their own rent issues, their own overhead issues, their own, I mean, it looks very unique for each and everybody. I don't know. I don't know exactly how it's going to be when we get out of it. I know that people's tendencies are going to change for quite some time. You know, just how you say hello, you know, just how people interact with each other, how they dine together, you know, the privacy that this is going to create. It's going to be interesting to see as a social experiment.
Yeah, I think our lives have forever changed. Like I was watching a show last night on TV, and they shook hands, and I was like, ooh, the people shaking hands. Yeah. It's just like fucking still, you know, like,
yeah,
it's crazy, man. It's crazy. Let me ask you, I saw you guys do something, and I understand the reasoning behind it, but I just want to get it from you. Something I thought I would never see Carbone do, but I was happy to see it actually. Delivery.
Yeah.
You guys had quite the interest. First of all, I want you to tell a little bit the thought process into making a decision, if possible. Yep. And then two, you guys had an eventful, you know, first days of delivery. Talk about that.
Unbelievable. Later. Yeah. So as we started closing the restaurants down for this, what we did, what many companies did was, you know, you got to consolidate your workforce, keep as many people on payroll as possible. You want it, you know, sort of identify your Green Berets, your A team, the team that you're going to need to restart this thing as fast as possible. As soon as you get the sniff of a green light, I need to go. So I need that team as close to me as possible. So we're going to condense ourselves down to this little Green Beret squad. And then it becomes, okay, in an effort to pay them when there's you know, if there's $0 coming in for an extended period of time, that's gonna put us at risk. So what's the smallest footprint way to get some revenue in to make sure that I can keep a staff on board, my most important people, my most tenured people, keep them getting paid? It was, you know, all right, what if we just turned on, what if Carbone did delivery? And at first it's like, oh, really? like delivery? And it's like, yeah, like let's not take the high road here. Like, let's just, you know, let's give it a shot. What if we did delivery? Like, maybe a lot of people would be down for that. Everyone's stuck at home, and with one restaurant, we could probably generate enough money to keep a decent number of people on payroll right now. So we set it up, and it was funny. The first night, man, we set it up like a restaurant. We were like, all right, you know, these are the numbers we normally do. You know, we sell, you know, on a normal night, Carbone will sell in New York, like 45 orders of rigatoni, 40, 50 orders of rigatoni, you know? So we're set up, got the kitchen going, ready to go. 5 o'clock comes around. We turn the machine on to do delivery, and it just rains out of it. I mean, it just poured out of the machine. You know, 400 orders of rigatoni later, we were like,
"Whoa,
yo, we need to reevaluate." And then we had
So Mario, so on an average day, you guys do 40 to 45 rigatoni orders.
For 200 people, 50 orders, yeah.
Okay, so on that, so let's say 50 orders, round number. On that first day you guys did deliver, you got 400 orders.
Yeah.
Which,
so then we let people,
right? It's the gift and the curse.
It's great, yeah. I mean, they had no, we were just scrambling. We were allowing people to do pickup, so we had people coming in to do pickup or like coming to the door. And then we had the drivers outside, the bike guys and all the drivers outside waiting for their orders. And we got backed up. So a crowd started to form, and the crowd got kind of angry, and they were waiting, they were getting hungry, and the orders were taking a while, and my guys were going down. And then the cops came, and the cops had to come, like it was a house party. The cops had to come and break it up. And we're like, yo, I'm not trying to cause a scene here. Like, I don't want people to, I know social, I get it, like, but we're going down. My guys are trying to make rigatoni right now, and it's a problem. And that's why they're waiting. And officer, listen, don't. I think eventually the cops had to shut us down. And they were like, yep, that's it for you. You're done for the night. I'm like, and then we kind of, you know, next night went slightly better, progressively better, until we figured it out. And now they have it down to a system.
Listen,
that was how it went.
You know me, I'm a marketer, I'm a branding guy. I looked at it and I was proud. I was like, Mario did like a sneaker release. Mario did the spicy rigatoni sneaker release. He shut the street down. Yeah.
That's it. I took a play from Ronnie's playbook, and I was like, yeah, we got a drop coming.
You crushed it. I loved it. Let me ask you, I think, you know, when you touched on like that Green Beret team and the people that have been tenured, look, you already know, I think you're the best chef in the world. Let me preface that. You and Chef D, which is LeBron's chef, I don't want to get starved when I go over his house next time I'm going to have to see him. You and Chef D are the best chefs in the world, and obviously deserve the bulk of the accolades and success for the success of Carbone and the other restaurants. I'll keep it to Carbone right now for this purposes of this conversation. I think equally as important to the success of Carbone is, like, it's my version. I'm older than most people watching this or listening to this. It's my version of Cheers. When I walk in Carbone,
yep,
you know, everyone knows you. Even if they don't, they treat you like they know you. They treat you like you're home. You get a firm handshake, show you to your table. The music's right. The staff is dressed right. You know, the waiters are kind of almost playfully offended if you ask them for a menu. It's like, what? Like, I got you. You know, like, talk a little bit about, like, that thing you've created. Because I'll give you one more example. I was there for a friend's birthday party. You know, we did a birthday dinner. It was probably about, I don't know, maybe 7 or 8 of us a couple of months ago. And at the end, one of my favorite things you guys do, they bring out the fruit and the nuts. And I was making a mess cracking the nuts and all that. And one of your waiters comes by and they're like, no, don't clean it up. Mario would be furious if we cleaned it up. Like, do your thing. And I don't know if you remember this. I posted a picture and the table was a complete wreck.
Yeah.
Like tangerine peels and walnut peels and glasses of wine. And you were like, that is beautiful.
Beautiful.
That's exactly what I want.
Beautiful.
A little bit about that, about like just the environment and how important that is to the DNA of Carbone.
Yeah, it's crucial. It's everything to me. You know, I like to think that we're storytellers and you know, we tell our stories through food. Mm. And it's very important that for me, when I'm doing a project, take Carbone, that when we're putting that story together, I am hyper specific. Like, I don't work well outside the box. I need to be inside of a box. And the smaller the box, the better for me. So I get really specific and I make rules so that I know when something is right. If it fit in that box, it's right, check. And it's sort of like when you're taking your carry-on luggage and if it doesn't fit in that thing, like it you can't bring it in. So like when we created Carbone, it had to be super specific. And if you nail, if you take that specificity through every detail, every detail, then what will happen over time is the customer coming in will walk in and they will immediately be transcended into, they're being moved to your movie. They're a character now in your movie. They're an extra because every little detail is perfect or like not perfect, but like set to the period. You know, so I even went to the extreme of, if you may not notice, but like on the menu cover, it has a year on it. It has 1958 on it because that was the year I pictured in my head, you know? So like what happens is, and I won't bore you with it, but like what happened to like how I got there is most of the Southern Italian immigrants left in the late 1800s, early 1900s. That was when the biggest movement was. So the Southern Italians were super poor. They left and they migrated. They went all over the world. New York got a lot of them. Early 1900s, 10s, 20s, they're young. They have kids. The first generation Italian Americans to ever exist are born on that soil in the 20s and 30s. They get older in the 40s and 50s. They're now old enough to be business owners. So in my head, that restaurant stands for the first generation of Italian Americans. And it's really important that it's the first generation because that means it's very close to Italy. It means their parents are speaking Italian to them, but they're learning English in school. That perfect hybrid, that period is super important because I'm Italian American, but as every generation goes on and has children, it will ultimately just assimilate into society. You'll just be an American.
It's further,
which is amazing. Further
in the beginning, yes. Yeah.
And that's a beautiful thing, right? That's a beautiful thing, but it will be at the sacrifice of a culture that had a moment in time. So if this restaurant is successful on the highest level, it will last beyond me and it will be basically a functioning museum to a period that 200 people a night can experience. So every detail's got to be right. Every detail's got to feel like that thing. And it's got to come from a place of authenticity. And if you get every detail right, the second you open that door, you walked into my movie. You walked into Thompson Street, 1958, first generation Italian Americans, and you're being welcomed home.
I love
it. That's how we got there.
No, I love it. And without giving away the secret sauce, no pun intended, how, you know, in theory, right, people can hear that and be like, yeah, that makes perfect sense. You know, when things are humming, you know, high season at any given time, what's the staff number at Carbone, give or take?
So the beauty of Carbone, and I've been working in restaurants since I was a little kid. I've been working in Manhattan since I was 18 years old. The beauty of Carbone, and there's less than 10 restaurants in New York City that no matter what time of year, no matter what day of the week, no matter what's happening in the world, no matter what time of day it is, it's full. We do the same number of people on Saturday as we do on Tuesday in wow. August and in September and in January. You know, we've been blessed over time now. It's 7 years old to have built up a demand to where we basically do 220 people every single night.
Wow.
You know, and it's just, it's basically the exact same number. It's just a different list of people. And you know, like we have, you know, we track all the people like yourself. We know all your likes and dislikes and tendencies, and you know, we do everything we can to make sure that you are having your norm moment when you walk into Carbone.
Dude.
You walk in and everyone's like, oh, PR. And like from Julian to Ricky to the chef, like
absolutely.
You're home, you know?
Absolutely. But let me ask, so right, people may not understand, but you know, from the guy at the front that opens the door to the young ladies that check you in, to the bartender that gets you a drink, you know, before you go to your table, to your waiter, to the chef, to the people clearing your plates, you know, your tables. That's a lot of people to get on the same page.
Yep.
You know, a very dear friend, it's family to both of us, Mav, you know, Maverick Carter, he always says that the best brands in the world, you know, whether you experience the brand in New York or Tokyo, it feels the same. It feels at home, right? Like that DNA of the brand. How do you accomplish that with so many people working for you that every time I go to Carbone, it feels like home, from the music to the messaging to the like just everything? How's that? Is that over time? Is that just, you know, it starts with you and like, talk to me a little bit about that.
You have to find a way to get buy-in. To have a waiter in Las Vegas buy into the same story I just told you about the building of Carbone in New York, I'll tell them the same story as to why Carbone in Las Vegas is just at home. It's just as indigenous to the city of Las Vegas as it is in the city of New York, which is 100, I believe in my heart, it's 100% true. I can see Dean Martin on the ninth hole in Nevada with a polo and a cigarette, just like I can see him in New York. Like this belongs here too. This is your home too. This restaurant belongs here. And get them to buy into the idea that what we're doing is not a shtick. We do this for the culture. We do it for a reason. We do it to take care of people. We do it to put on a good show, to put out a good product. We have great pride in what we do. And yeah, it starts with us. It starts with ownership. And if it trickles down to a buy-in by all staff members, then you're preaching from a place of real earnestness. You're getting real disciples. You're getting people who can you know, if there's many people that don't even know there is a Mario Carbone, you know, like they just know that it's a restaurant, you know. But I think if you spoke to someone who ate at my restaurant who had never met me before, they would have, after their experience, they would have a pretty good idea of who I am. And that means I'm doing a good job. I'm doing it right. They don't need to speak to me directly. They could talk to Louis. They could talk to Julian. They could talk to the girl behind the counter. They could talk to a busboy and go into the kitchen, talk to a line cook. I bet you you're going to get pretty close to the same story as you would have gotten from me.
I love it. As I've gotten older, like I feel like, you know, and I know you feel the same way. It's like I've gotten into things like I only want to like experience things that are like timeless or classic, right? We're not into fads or what's in now, whatnot. And I feel like, and I truly mean this, it's not because we're having this conversation. I feel like Carbone, and you kind of touched on it with Dean, Carbone's one of those establishments and experiences, quite frankly, that I can very vividly envision Sinatra and his crew coming yeah. after a show and having a drink and a good meal. I can envision us eating there as we do maybe too often, you know. I can envision my son eating there with his friends, you know, 10, 15 years from now. You know, is that, you know, that's not by coincidence.
It's a wonderful byproduct of a ton of hard work. You know, it's an amazing byproduct of that. And not something that I could have thought about or I should be thinking about when I first started building it or when we first got open. But as you look back now at 7 years under your belt, like, it's an amazing byproduct to meet the son of the guy who's been coming in all these years now, and to know that it's going to be here for quite some time, and it's going to meet a lot of people. It, the building, it, the restaurant, it, the museum, is going to stand here for quite some time. And it is a beautiful, beautiful byproduct of just sweating every detail, just laboring over everything, not allowing anything that's going to be outside the box. You know, what I tell the chefs, you know, we talk a lot about the ambiance, but like what I tell the chefs is, you know, what we're trying to do here, what we're putting our energy towards, what we're putting our talent towards is what we're going to do here tonight is we're going to make food that people are totally familiar with. We're handing menus to people of dishes that they've had all of them before in their lives. Mm-hmm. The challenge in front of us is to try to make the very best version of that. Now, you could go the other side when there's nothing wrong with going the other side. Take the other perspective and say, what I'm going to do as a chef is I'm going to make you something you've never had before. I'm going to try to make you something you've never had before in your whole life and wow you with that. And that's a noble goal. But if that customer turns around and says, you know, I didn't really like it, that chef is able to fall back on, you didn't get it. You didn't get my interpretation of it.
I'm too in the future for you. I'm too ahead of you. I'm too ahead of you on this thing.
We don't have that net to fall on. I can't be like, yeah, you know, you didn't get my lasagna. You didn't, it's just like, no, it's probably just not that good. Like, I've had 1,000 lasagnas. I've had veal parm a million times before. Like, yours just isn't that good. Like, I don't have that net to fall back on. We're making things that people know what it should be, what it should taste like, what it should look like. But still the goal is to make the best one. So that's how I try to train the next generation of young chefs in the Carbone kitchen.
I think, and I hope you don't take this any other way than how I intended, which is the utmost compliment, you know, and tribute to you. I've been to restaurants when I can tell, oh, the chef ain't here. I can't tell when you're not at Carbone anymore.
Right.
And I mean it as a compliment where it's like, you know, you have things so dialed that it's like the service, the quality, the experience is the same whether you're there in the kitchen with an apron on, whether you're at a table enjoying yourself and you know, hosting, or whether you're in Vegas. You know, that has to feel kind of special for you as well.
Yeah, that's as good a compliment as you can give me. Yeah, that's as good as a compliment as you can give me.
So you
100%.
Good, so I'm glad that's how you took it. So one last comment, I guess, before we go to this next thing I'm about to ask you. You actually blew my mind when you said Carbone's only 7 years old. I thought it was much longer than that. I didn't realize it's only been 7 years.
Yeah.
How's it feel to go from a thought, an idea of this restaurant, right, to, let me see, to four words, four words for you. Last table at Carbone. To be able to go from an idea to the biggest artist in the world, you know, naming you, you know, prominently in a verse. And that artist obviously being Drake.
Maybe it never gets old and that's just how it goes. Last table left in Carbone, calling plays on a rotary phone.
It's, you know, it's an honor, man. I mean, I could not have ever imagined it, you know. And if I was imagining it back then, I wouldn't have had my eye on the prize. You know, like it was head down for a long time, not knowing that maybe I shouldn't be here, you know, like not even thinking about it, not like just keep going. At the time of opening Carbone, it felt like we can do this. You know, we're biting off maybe more than we can chew, but we can do this. And, you know, at first we hit some adversities and, you know, it wasn't immediately accepted. But to go from that place of good intentions to this place today of sort of pop culture is unexplainable, you know. I'm really happy that I took the road that I did, that I'm not a face. I really love meeting people for the first time and them not knowing that there was, that there's even a Carbone, and that it just sort of stands for this thing of ours. And it's beautiful. You know, I mean, Drake's been so kind to us and so generous with his words, but the one that got me, you know, Nas dropped it. Yes. On his last album.
I'm in my neighborhood of stadiums, the Mets kind, with restaurants and Carbone, spicy rigatoni, go hard, a red Bordeaux, oh God.
And I can vividly remember being in my cousin's 1996 Camaro, bumping Nas down the streets of Queens as a fellow Queens kid. To have that memory and to know that he's now using me in a verse, that one was like tear to the eye. That was like, whoa, whoa.
That's royalty, man. That's gold royalty.
That's royalty.
I'll tell you a very quick, funny story. LeBron was still with the Cavs the second time. He had come back to the Cavs.
Yep.
And he was in town, I believe, to play the Brooklyn Nets. And as is customary at this point, when he's in town, he's like, it's not, are we going to Carbone? It's like, what night are we going to Carbone, right? So we go to Carbone, and it's me, LeBron, Randy, who's the best in the world. I think Mav's with us. And then it's a couple of LeBron's teammates, right? It's like Tristan and a couple of people. And we have the corner table, like, in the back. So you go to the back and the right, like the big yep. table. So we're there, and we're having a spectacular time, as we always do. The music's right, the vibe's right, service is right, room is beautiful, food's incredible, wine's great. And we're probably like on our fourth or fifth bottle of wine at this point. And the night's winding down. I think we might be like the only ones there at this point. It's like, you know, a little north of midnight. And I can't remember the guy's name, but it was a rookie on the team. And, you know, As you probably know, when NBA teams come to New York, they're excited they're in New York. It's like, we're going to go out. We're going to get a good meal. We're going to go to the club. We're going to party, do all these things. It's New York. So, you know, we're winding down, and I think Bron asked for the check. And the rookie on the team goes, man, this was great. Like, where are we going next? Where's the turn up? And Bron looks at him, I swear to you, Mario, without skipping a beat, without even trying to be funny, he goes, the turn up? He's like, we're at Carbone. This is the turn up. He goes, if you want to get crazy, we can order another bottle of wine. This is the turn up. And I will never forget that, because he wasn't trying to be funny. He was dead serious. Like, he's gotten to a place in his career and in his life where he's like, no, this is the vibe I'm going for.
As good as it gets.
From here back to the hotel, like, this is the vibe. This is the turn up. So I remind him of that like twice a year. And he was like, yo, P, I was dead serious. Like, what are you talking about, young fella? If you want to get really spicy and crazy, we'll order another bottle or two. But this is it. This is the night, you know? So with that said, I had an idea, which I talked to you about before. Let me pour a glass of wine. I shared something with you, and clearly I'm sharing it with people now that I haven't really shared broadly. I've never cooked.
Like, when you say that.
Hard stop, Mario. Like, it's a little embarrassing. Let me explain to you how I've never cooked. I was raised by my mom and basically my three sisters. I have one older and two younger, but basically raised by all women. I'm Puerto Rican. You know, they get busy in the kitchen, all of them.
Yep.
And it was more so a, like, you're in the way, get out the kitchen, what do you want type thing. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
I never learned how to cook, like, ever. Like, outside of making, like, a hard-boiled egg, I can do something on the grill. I can get on the grill and, like, make some, you know, chicken or something. But cooking, never.
All right.
So I thought it would be a great idea if you taught me. I'm actually at a friend's house in the Hamptons. You know, he's here, so it's just me. I thought it'd be a great idea if you could teach me how to make something super simple.
All right.
You know, so I'm nervous. I'm putting myself out there. So what? I'm going to show you what I bought. I bought like some pastas. I don't know if they're the right pastas.
All right.
I bought like meat sauce. So let me show you what I have and you tell me what our plan is.
A little hidden basket. Listen,
can we toast? We're in this together now. Like, I'm basically like, you're, yeah. All right.
Let's go. I'm going to teach PR to make something.
Okay. So I bought, let's start with the pasta.
This is going to be interesting.
Okay, I got, because I've seen this box.
What we got?
I got this.
Pacheco.
Okay.
Right. Rigatoni. We got rigatoni there? Oh, rigatoni. Yep. I know that shape.
Little rigatoni.
I heard it.
Okay.
I heard of that one.
Yeah. I honestly don't know what this is.
Yeah, you got a little rusticella. Okay, that's nice.
I got that.
Good brand. I like that.
And then I got this, which I believe is like this, basically like spaghetti.
What's it say? Bucatini?
Capellini?
Okay, capellini.
Yeah, capellini. Those are our three options.
All right.
And then I'm going to show you two other things I have. I have, and Mario, you're my friend, so do not judge me. You're my brother.
Yeah. We got some rails. You got some rails?
I would never do that. No. Let's not get carried away. I got a meat sauce that they had, and I got another meat sauce that they had.
Okay, we're not going to use either one of those. Put those away.
And then I got like ground turkey. I don't know if that helps or hurts our situation.
That makes it interesting. All right.
Clear Mario, listen, I've been surviving out here in the Hamptons like on like peanut butter cookies.
No, we're not tonight. Not tonight.
Talk to me. Right. What are you doing?
We need a pot of water. You got a pot of water?
Pot of water. Okay.
Let's get a nice pot. It's nice sized pot of water on the fire.
Okay. Are we doing like this or like this?
You can do that. You can do the smaller one.
This one?
Okay. Yeah.
Quarter full, half full?
So like a little more than half.
A little more than half. Okay.
Put a lid on it. Put it on high.
Okay. So while I'm filling this thing up, I want to go back a little bit to the beginning because, you know, you and I, you know, spent some time in Aspen and I was actually surprised to hear that. Like, you went to, like you're a trained chef. It's not like you grew up and your mom taught you how to cook. And, like, talk a little bit about, like, how you got there and, like, what the process was of, like, going to school and being a trained chef.
Yeah. I mean, I got the, you know, the cooking bug very, very, very early, like a little kid. My grandparents on my mom's side were from Italy, and every memory I have of my grandfather has an apron on in every memory of
I'm really cooking. Mario, I'm really cooking. I'm over here.
That's
like
it, baby. Put it on the fire on high with a lid.
Okay.
He would wake up, he would get dressed, and he would put an apron on immediately. He was just ready to be cooking all day. And no matter what he was doing, watching TV, listening to music, answering the door, he had his apron on. He was just ready.
Wow.
And I would spend a lot of time at their house, and they would babysit me. And I would, if I wanted to see them, I would have to be in the kitchen. So my grandma would always be assisting him. He'd be making something. I'd be in the kitchen. And, you know, there's pictures of me at one in his arms, sort of basting a turkey, you know, Thanksgiving. So I always grew up around food. I was fascinated by it. I was fascinated by restaurants. You know, we would go even to like whatever, you know, not at all fancy neighborhood restaurants, but I was fascinated as a kid. Like, I couldn't believe they would hand me a menu and I'd be able to pick anything I want. And then they would just bring it to me. Like, how does that happen? How do they know I was coming? How do they know I was going to order that? You know? And like all the things about a restaurant was just fascinating me. And, you know, I was a really, in high school, I was just really poor academically. I didn't apply myself at all. I didn't see the importance of school. I'd mess around with my friends. I didn't pay attention. And I got just whatever grades, you know, like if I didn't really take the challenge of making food my profession, if I would have just kind of stayed on the local path, I was probably just headed to community college to get a whatever degree in in whatever. And I may have never found this thing that I was able to do, this creative outlet.
Mario, how early are you thinking, like, hey, I can make a profession out of food? How early are you thinking that?
High school.
Okay.
You know, I think high school, probably, like, I started working in, like, local restaurants, like, for actually getting a paycheck at, like, 15, 16. And once I stepped into, like, a kitchen, I caught that bug. I caught the bug of, like, that energy of a restaurant, of the ticket machine, and the guy cooking, grilling, the fry guy, and the waitress comes in, and they're yelling at each other. And, like, that whole energy, like, caught me. And I was like, I love this. Like, this is a place. You know, it was full of misfits, and like no one was, there was no academias there. You were among the people. Like, you were just, it was real blue collar. This is almost even before, this is at the beginning of the Food Network. Like, this, it wasn't even, I wasn't even telling my friends I was doing this after school, because it wasn't cool yet.
I was just gonna say, you told me, like, this wasn't even like it was cool being a chef. This was a passion. This is before it was cool to be a chef.
Yeah. You know, the only ones who were making it, the only chefs I had to look up to were like kind of like the European chefs. Like there was like a few shows on that I would see after school, like Jacques Pepin and like the Traveling Gourmet and like these old shows that I would watch, but like there wasn't really the Food Network yet. And you know, eventually I thankfully made the right decision that like I'm gonna. And the way I saw it, I really saw it like a vocation. Like I was going to like Apex Tech. Like I was going to like get a vocational degree to do something with my hands, because I wasn't going to make it with my mind. And that is a lot of how I saw it. I didn't think to myself, I'm going to go be an artist. Right. I was like, I'm going to go learn this trade that's going to make me a living.
Gotcha.
And along that path, I caught that next bug, the bug of the artistry of it and the beauty of it. So it was in stages.
Did it click for you, like, the minute you're in a kitchen and start actually cooking and stuff, you're like, oh, are you like, do you realize early on you're good at this thing?
No, there's not, I don't think there's gifted, you know? There's no, you know, culinary LeBrons being born, you know? There's nobody that's just, like, got that chromosome. And even he, you know, he kills himself every day.
I would argue you do, but I'll defer to you.
Nah, I think you just, you know, you learn the trade, and along the way, at each set of challenges, at each next level, you have to love that level. And if you don't fall in love with the next phase, at some point, you're going to get eliminated. And it's this sort of tournament of life, you know, and like, you've got to keep advancing and you've got to keep falling in love with the next set of challenges. And if you don't really love it, you're going to be exposed.
It's so interesting you say that. I mean, you mentioned LeBron, but like, and I'm not even trying to be funny. I hear a lot of LeBron and you, where LeBron constantly says it's public knowledge, he'll always say, like, you have to fall in love with the process. Like, everyone falls in love with the champagne shower after the championship and all of that stuff, but it's like, you have to love the process of off-season workouts. You have to love the process of learning. You have to love that process. So it sounds like it's sort of a similar process for you along the way of, like, you know, falling in love with learning and kind of doing the actual work.
It's too hard to not. If you don't genuinely have love for it, it's too hard. It's going to eliminate you along the way. I mean, it's one of those industries. If you're not fully in love with it along the way, it'll beat you down and you'll quit. It's just the way it is. It's too difficult. You have to be totally enamored with it.
Got it. So you decide, you know, you want to make a living or a profession or a trade out of cooking or the food industry. What's your thought process? Like, you're like, okay, I have to go to school. What's that like?
Yeah.
You decide to go to school.
I got to go to school. I guess, you know, I don't have a mentor. I guess I got to go to school. Although when I give advice today, I don't assume that that's the answer, you know, okay, when I'm talking to somebody. But at the time, yeah, that's how I thought. I should go to school for this. The best school in America by most people is considered is in New York. It's in upstate New York in Hyde Park, the Culinary Institute of America. I began looking into, you know, what does it take to get into that school while I was in high school. And it was really more about, do you have a certain amount of working history under your belt already? They wanted to see that you were working for a certain amount of time in the industry and that this wasn't just a fad for you. This was something you actually were going to do. You've gone through X number of hours in the business and you still want to do it? Okay. Now we'll look into, you know, your grades and, you know, recommendations and you're applying to a college.
Did you have that, so, like through your work experience, like working in restaurants?
I had that. I had enough of that. Okay. And then I needed letters of recommendation from like the chefs I had worked for saying that I had actually done these tasks and I would qualify in school. So I was thankfully accepted to the school and I started in September of 98. I met my business partner my first day there, Rich Terese. I met him day one at orientation.
You met him at school?
Yeah, day one orientation. Yeah.
And he was just in school as a student as well?
Yeah.
Wow.
We were starting the same day.
Wow.
Yeah. And then our paths would just keep crossing over the next decade until we wound up in business together. But that was the first time I met him.
Wow. And what's that school experience like? You can't say like, hey, I'm Mario Carbone. I want to make Italian food. Like, that's not how that works, right? Like, what's the school curriculum like?
It's very unorthodox. So they call it block systems. So each class is 3 weeks long. So there's not a start day and a graduation day. It's constantly evolving. So every 3 weeks is a new class and every 3 weeks is a graduation basically. And someone's starting and someone's ending. And it's either a 2-year degree or it's a 4-year degree. So your first class is culinary math. And it's really basically learning ounces and grams and the conversions of pounds. And you're learning all, it's hyper-focused on just the things you need to know. So the first class is culinary math. The second class is like introduction into your knife skills and like the beginning of using a knife, and slowly they build you up along the way, but you're going pretty quick. Each class is only 3 weeks long, and it's very much military. You're in uniform. Your uniform has to be tight, it has to be clean, it has to be pressed, it has to be precise. You're in a very much a French dictated style of learning the classic way of cooking. How you address people, how everyone's looking. You basically, if you walk on campus, it's a culinary military school.
And how's a young Mario Carbone like assimilating to this? Like, are you like, okay, like I feel like I'm at home, or I don't know if this is for me? Like, what's your journey going through that?
For the most part, I was okay. I think we all hit our challenges along the way. But I always had this confidence that even when I saw other people fail, I always had this confidence inside that said, I'm going to be okay. Like, I'm going to survive. Like, there was something that gave me, there's something about choosing that profession and knowing that it was kind of always meant for me that said that even though this obstacle, whatever it is in front of me, you're going to be okay. Like, you'll make it out of this. You know, the goals were not super lofty. They were graduate from this great school, make it out of here, get a good job in Manhattan, learn from a really great chef, and maybe someday you'll open something of your own. Like, that's as far as you can see at that point.
So that was the goal. The goal as you're going through school is like, you just want to get a good job.
You want to get a good job. You want to work for a great chef. It's not about making money. It's about learning from that guy, and along the way, you'll build up your resume, and maybe you'll make a name for yourself someday. Maybe, you know, but step one is get through this school. The school's kind of, you know, it feels at the time it feels tough. You know, it's this thing that's regimented. You know, I came from a Catholic high school, so I was used to sort of the white shirt and tie every day. Yeah. And so it wasn't that tough for me to get into the military uniform portion of it. And, you know, by and large, I did pretty well. I mean, by no means did Mario Carbone graduate at the top of his class. By no means. Like, I did okay. I made it out, and I learned a good amount of the school, and I did okay. I didn't excel until my work ethic was the thing that separated me. It wasn't when I got to the point in my life when it wasn't about the skill and it wasn't about my knowledge. And this is only for a period of time. Like, at some point that stops too. But over the next 10 years, I advanced in life because I just outworked the guy next to me.
Wow.
And it wasn't, I was never the most talented. I'm still not the most talented. I'm still not the smartest. There's tons of chefs that are better than me. But I outwork most of them, and I have a clear vision. I have a clear thought process. I know where my limitations are. I know where I can push those, and I know what I'm really good at. And that's helped me along the way.
You know what's so crazy, Mario, to hear you say that? I was having a conversation. It was me, Mab, Jeff, Draymond, and Danny Silman, who I believe you know. And and just, you know, through conversation, someone asked, like, hey, does everyone play golf or something like that? And I was like, no, I don't play. And Draymond was like, I don't play because it goes against everything I stand for. And we started laughing, like, it's not that serious a question, Dre. And as he explained it further, it made perfect sense. He said, I am not the most athletic guy. I'm not the biggest guy. I'm not the strongest guy. I'm not the smartest guy. He goes, I have gotten everything in my life because I have worked harder than everyone else, and I have willed myself. And he said, golf goes against all of that. The harder you try, the worse you are. He goes, so I know that's a sport I will never be good at. And he said that, and we were all like, huh, holy shit, that makes perfect sense. And to hear you say that, there's so many similarities of like, hey, there is a phase when it is about the books and learning and all of those things that are integral to, you know, that setting that solid foundation. And then at some point, whether it's a chef, a marketer, an athlete, or whatever it is, it's about the work.
Yeah.
You know, and hearing you say that's like super dope. One thing I want to ask you on is you said when you first started, it sounded like school was the natural next step. It was like you had to go to school. Yeah. You said you may not necessarily give that advice today. Talk a little bit about that. Like, what's the difference in?
So I say the same thing now every time. If it's a parent or if it's a student, I say the exact same thing every time when I'm asked this question. If I'm asked the question or a version of this question, do you think I should enter this industry? In some way, they'll ask that question, and I get it a good amount, either from a parent of a kid or from the kid directly. Do you think this is for me? Do you think I should do this in some fashion? My answer is always the same. I say no, period. Pause. And I wait for it. And I wait for their reaction. And the reaction says a lot to me. The reaction will say a lot to me. And then their reaction to the conversation. I say the answer, no, you shouldn't.
Why?
And then often they say, why? And I'll say, because the fact that you're asking the question means there's a small amount of doubt inside of you. And that little bit of doubt inside of you will get exposed to something much, much larger along the way, because this is going to be the most difficult, painful thing you've ever been a part of. Mm-hmm. It's so hard. That little bit of doubt that's asking me that question right now is going to get exposed to something that I'm going to tell you right now you shouldn't do. Now, there's two ways that person's going to take that advice. They're going to say, I had doubt in me, and you know what? I'm not going to do it. That guy said don't do it, and they're going to leave, and I just eliminated them in the eliminator of life. In the tournament of life, I just eliminated them, and it was far too easy to eliminate that person. They should have been eliminated. Or it's the person that's going to say, no, this is for me. I'm going to do this. I don't care what that guy says. They advanced. Like, And then there's the person that doesn't need to ask. That's mm-hmm. never going to ask, is this for me? They know it's for them. They're going to just do it. Mm-hmm. So either you took my advice and you asked the question. There's nothing wrong with that. You got my answer. You're going to take that answer and you're going to use that as fuel. Great. You're going to take that answer and you're going to easily you're going to easily be eliminated. You didn't belong here anyway. Mm-hmm. And then there's a person that never asked the question that's just going to do it.
Got it. Love it. Love it. Mario, let's check in on this pot over here. I don't know what's going on.
Is it hot?
We're going to look. We're going to look right now. It's
we
boiled it.
Oh, nice. 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 Okay. All right.
I passed the first test. I boiled some
more. The first test. You're almost at dinner. All right.
What am I doing?
All right. Lower the fire a little bit.
Okay.
And now go to the spice cabinet. Let's see what we got.
The spice cabinet is like really like... You're giving me too much credit.
Just
because I'm Puerto Rican, you'll appreciate this. There's some adobo here, for sure.
Okay, adobo, nice. Pull it out.
We have adobo. We have black peppercorns.
No, don't need it. No, nope, maybe. Put it aside.
We have sea salt.
Okay, great. Okay. Pull it out.
We have pepper.
Okay.
We have more salt. We have onion powder.
Okay, very good.
I don't even know what this is. We're scraping the bottom of the barrel now, Mario. I don't even know.
We got any chilies or anything? Any peppers?
We are struggling.
Any hot pepper? Nothing? All right.
I have garlic over here somewhere. I don't know if that helps.
Okay. What's in the fridge? You got any cheese or anything?
In the fridge.
You got any olive oil?
I have olive oil.
All right. You got any butter?
I have butter.
Okay. We got any cheese?
What kind of cheese?
What do you got?
I have like sliced cheese, nothing good. No, more like cold cut cheese. I have extra virgin oil and I have butter.
Okay. Got it. We need it. Put them out.
Okay. What are we doing now?
What else we got? I know we need like one more ingredient. I need one more thing.
Like what?
What's in that fridge?
Slim Pickens over here, Mario.
We got rosé.
I said.
We got okay. Rosé. You got any other deli meats?
We have asparagus. We have.
Okay.
I don't know what this is. We have Genoa salami.
Okay. Nice.
That's kind
of it. Yeah. What kind of sliced deli cheese you got?
I have Swiss, and I have mild cheddar cheese.
Ooh. Okay. Give me the cheddar.
Okay. We'll do cheddar.
Okay.
This is your biggest. Challenge as a chef in a long time, by the way.
All right, here's the things I want to pull. I want to pull out. All right. Let's see. Let's take the.
I love this, by the way. I love this. Yes.
I'm trying to make it simple. All right. Get a pan. Get a big pan.
Got a pan. Like this?
What is that?
Okay, not like this. Okay, not like this.
It's square. I've never seen a square pan before.
I got this?
Yeah, that's good. That's good.
Hey, Marta, hold up. I didn't like your tone, bro. What is that? Okay, we got a pan.
Okay. All right. Put the pan on a burner. Don't turn the burner on yet.
Don't turn the burner on. Okay.
Open the lid to the water, to the pot of water.
Okay, we're cracking our boiling water over here.
Take the salt, put some salt in the water.
Okay. How much salt? Like a pinch, like?
Put a good amount in there. Yeah, a lot. A lot. A lot. Enough salt to where I want you to taste the water like it's soup. Like, oh, yeah, you need like four times that amount of salt.
Okay, I got you.
Put a lot of salt in the water.
All right, we're going to do this. I'm going to have you here, like, you said I should be able to taste it?
Yeah, you should, the water should taste of a little bit of salt. It shouldn't be bland.
Oh, you know what? I'm going to open this one. Okay, now we're about, our pour game's about to
Start, Mario. Okay. Stop.
There we go. Okay.
Next thing you're going to do is take the cappellini pasta. Open the bag.
Cappellini.
The spaghetti one.
Yep, this one. Cappellini. Yep. Okay.
How many minutes does it say to cook on the bag?
It says 2 to 3 minutes.
2 to 3?
Yeah.
Great. All right. That's fast. We're gonna put the pasta in the water before we even make the sauce. We're gonna make sauce in 2 to 3 minutes.
Well, I gotta open this. Mario, are you sure this is gonna turn out okay?
No, I'm not.
Okay, it's open. I'm putting. What am I doing with this?
Take like,
I mean, we could cook it all and I could store some. That's fine.
No, take like half of it and throw it in the water.
Okay, half of it. Okay, half of it, and we're putting it in the water.
Yeah. Now we got 3 minutes to make our sauce.
Okay, half of it's in there.
Okay.
Which sauce? Take your,
no, neither one. Out.
All
turn
right.
Turn the pan on.
Pan on. Okay, it's on.
Put some olive oil in the pan.
Is it high, medium, or low?
Medium.
Medium. Okay.
Put some olive oil in the pan.
How much olive oil? Like cover the whole pan?
But a thin layer cover the pan.
Okay, here we go.
Stop.
Okay.
You got some garlic, you said, right?
I do have some garlic.
Well, get one piece of garlic.
It's the actual, like, garlic.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Give me one.
This.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Put it on the table and smash it with your hand. It'll break it open.
Oh, it just flew somewhere.
Take one piece out.
Like this?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now peel the skin off.
Peel the skin off.
You can smash it again to make it easy.
Wow, you know.
Now peel the skin.
You know all the tricks, Mario. You've done this once or twice.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Good. All right. Take that whole thing, throw it in the pan.
The whole thing.
Yeah.
Okay. I've learned you don't question LeBron James on the basketball court, so I'm not going to question you. I'm just going to throw this whole thing on the pan.
Good. We're just flavoring the oil.
Okay.
You got black pepper there, right?
I do have black pepper. This, right?
Is it ground? Yeah. Crack a shitload in the pan.
In the pan with the garlic.
Oil. Yeah, yeah. Crack a bunch of black pepper.
Move the tears so you can see me.
Right a lot.
Yeah. Okay. A lot.
Stir the pasta so it doesn't stick too. You got like tongs?
A lot right now.
You're in. This is called the shits. You're in the shits.
I'm in it right now. Okay, I stirred the pasta.
Okay, black pepper.
Black pepper. A shit ton.
Boom. Yeah. Boom. Boom. Hey, go.
I like the school of Mario. A shit ton is a measurement.
Go. Just don't stop.
It actually smells decent already.
Yeah.
Wow, my wrist is getting tired. I keep going?
Yeah, just keep going. You're making Roman food right now.
Roman food.
Yeah.
Okay.
Out of the simplest of ingredients.
By the way, I want all the listeners and viewers to know, I asked Mario what I should buy to prepare for this. What did you tell me?
Surprise me.
Surprise me? We can make a meal out of anything.
Anything.
Okay, here we are.
All right. Done. Stop.
Okay.
Okay. You said you got butter in the fridge, right?
I have butter out here. Yep. I have sticks of butter.
Okay. Cut a quarter of that stick into a cube, into a piece.
A quarter of a stick, okay. A quarter of a stick. Okay. About this much?
Now cut that into a couple pieces just so it melts. Doesn't matter. Throw it into your pan.
And throw it in the pan?
Yep.
I'm like a real fucking chef out here, Mario.
Turn the pan off.
Turn it off?
Yeah, off.
Off, okay.
Now take some of the water. Do you have a ladle?
I do not.
Okay, you have this big spoon?
I do have a big spoon. Oh, I do, yep. I have a big spoon right here like this.
Yeah, perfect. Take 2 spoonfuls of the water you're cooking the pasta in and put it in the pan.
Huh. That's normal?
Yeah.
Okay, 2.
Again. Okay. Do one more. One more. Okay. Give it a little swirl.
This smells good as shit, I ain't gonna lie.
Yeah, you know it does. All right, your pasta's done. Drain the pasta.
Pasta's done, turn it off.
Now you gotta drain it. You got some sort of draining mechanism?
We're gonna figure this shit out right now, Mario. No draining mechanism. We're gonna do this like the Lower East Side style and just drain it.
But into what?
In the sink, we're gonna drain it, Mario.
You sure? I'm sure there's something in that kitchen where you could drain it.
I got it. Trust me on this.
Oh, no.
That don't sound like trust, Mario.
I'm not sure about this Puerto Rican style we got going over here.
Okay, now we're doing good so far. Nothing's falling out, and we're draining the water.
Okay. Once you're done, put it in the pan.
In the pan with the
oh? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. You can take the garlic out now.
I can take the garlic out. All right. Yeah. So I'm gonna put all this pasta in this pot.
Yeah.
Oh shit. Okay. I can take the garlic out, you said?
Yeah. You're not gonna eat it. You were just flavoring. Okay. Now turn the fire back on under the pan and show me what that looks like.
Okay.
Now give it a good stir.
How high should the fire be?
Low.
Okay, too low.
Now, how much extra liquid is there in that pan?
There's a good amount of extra liquid.
Okay, so now you're just going to simmer it until the liquid starts to go away.
Okay.
And the starch from the pasta and the starch from the water that you took out of the cooking, you know, because as the pasta cooks in the water, it's giving the starch off. So you use the water that has the starch in it in the pan, and it'll thicken it.
Got it. God, there's a science to your art, Mario, I see. Okay, so do I stir it or do I leave it like that?
You want to kind of keep stirring it?
Okay.
How's it look?
It looks. So, Mario, while I'm doing this, let me ask you, you finished school.
Yeah.
When do you know, what's your first job out of school? That's actually a good question.
I'm concerned about the pasta. Let me see it.
You have no faith in my God. My God, no faith.
It's a critical time here. Oh, yeah, it looks good. Stir, stir, stir.
Okay, stir. So what's your first gig out of school?
Taste it. How's it taste?
I could taste it?
Yeah, taste it. What does it taste like? How's it taste?
Well, that feels good.
I mean, yeah. How's the salt? Tastes good?
This one I start getting spicy with, like, it's all on the wrist now, Mario.
Yeah. All you're missing right now is some cheese.
Cheese? I don't have cheese. I wish I would have had, like, grated cheese. Oh, hold up a second. I got Parmesan, like, grated cheese. Does that help?
My man, you're holding out on me.
Damn it, Mario! It's already grated, but I have this.
Yeah, all right, perfect, yes. Okay. Turn the fire off. And put a big handful of grated cheese in there, toss it all around, and you're done.
This is my style right here. Whole hand, look, there you go, okay.
This dish is called cacio e pepe.
Cacio e pepe?
Yeah.
Cacio e pepe. Okay, a whole, like a lot?
Yeah, put like a nice big pinch in there. Go. More. More.
Yeah.
Stop.
Okay.
Now toss all that together. It should come together nice here. And then,
Mario, listen, we'll be honest with you. If you want to go half a little pop up in the Hamptons while we're out here, well, I might be available. I might have some time.
That's it. All you need to do now is just put some in a bowl and then top it with some more black pepper, maybe a little more cheese if you want it, and you're done. You got very simple pasta here.
Wow.
This is from the Roman ghetto.
The Roman ghetto?
Yeah. This is as humble a food as it gets.
This is amazing, man. I don't know if you realize what a big moment this is for me, man. Mara, let me
tell you, it's done.
And you're like super early in your career and you have so many more things to accomplish, and I truly believe we'll get out of this situation we're in. What do you want Mario Carbone? How do you want Mario Carbone, the chef, to be remembered?
I want to be remembered with the first line being that Mario Carbone started as a chef.
That's simple to you.
Well, if that's the first line, then it means that there's a lot more to come.
I love it.
If that's not the first line, then all I did was be a chef, and it'll talk about that. If it says that I started as a chef, I bet there's something else behind it that's still to be determined.
It's like they say, life's all about the dash in between the start and the end date, right?
That's it, baby.
Mara, I want to thank you for your time, brother. I will send you pictures of this as I enjoy it. I'll probably eat all of it tonight.
Your first home cooked meal. I love it.
Cheers to you, brother. I appreciate you.
All right, cheers to you, but I needed all my wine to get through.
Come on, Mario. Listen, I'm going to hit you. I'm going to come see you. You're like my neighbor.
Come on, baby. I got fresh fish in Montauk.
I'm going to come see you. Appreciate you, brother. Cheers.
I love you.
Love. Peace.